there are various things that influence the romantic revival. There are various things that influence the romantic revival. French Revolution, American Revolution, and Napoleonic Wars all have their roles in shaping the romantic revival. French Revolution took place between 1789 and 99. It was in 1789 the prison of Bastille was broken down and the revolution started in 1787. And the American Revolution actually took place in 1775 for the liberation of the colonies. And 13 colonies were liberated during the American Revolution. And Napoleonic Wars, after the French Revolution, the rule of France came under Napoleon. Napoleon was a despot. And he ruled France and tried to conquer most of the European countries. Tried to war with the European countries. Between 1803 and 1815. So it was during the period the Romantics lived. And they were all influenced by these important incidents. And French Revolution actually gave spirit of equality and individualism. And it was fight against the monarchy by common man. And the working class liberated after years of oppression. And the popular slogan of the French Revolution was liberty, equality and fraternity. And the French Revolution was actually a communist revolution. The revolution simulated writers like Wordsworth, Coleridge, Southey, Burns, Byron and Shelley. Even though Byron and Shelley were late, they could not see French Revolution. They were very young. They were children when there was the revolution. Even then, they were also influenced by the French Revolution. Wordsworth, Coleridge, Southey, Burns, Byron and Shelley all wrote poetry celebrating the revolution. And there were a few pamphlets published during the revolution. One came out from Edmund Burke, a lord during the period, and he was a close associate and friend of Horace Walpole. Horace Walpole also didn't support the French Revolution. And Edmund Burke produced an essay, Reflections on the Revolution in France, that appeared in 1790. Just after the fall of the Bastille, Edmund Burke produced a pamphlet called Reflections on the Revolution in France. It condemned, the essay condemned the French Revolution, criticized the French Revolution, and he maintained that so the revolution was actually nothing important but for making money and power. And it was nothing important. And it was written in the format of a lecture. Edmund Burke's essay, Revolution in France, Reflections on Revolution in France, that appeared in 1719, was addressed to a French aristocrat, Charles Jean Francois de Pons. So it's a name that we have to remember. Charles Jean Francois de Pons. The essay by Edmund Burke was addressed to a French aristocrat. And he was a French aristocrat who lived during the French Revolution. And this aristocratic man was also affected by the revolution. He was also put under various difficulties. Charles Jean Francois de Pons. And Edmund Burke produced an essay addressed to Charles Francois de Pons. And he regarded French Revolution as an eloquent statement of British conservatism. And it was actually, the essay was an eloquent statement of British conservatism. Edmund Burke was a lord, and in fact he was a conservative. And Horace Walpole was also a lord and parliament member. He was also a conservative. And they favored monarchy and aristocracy. And he argued for constitutional reform and not revolution. Edmund Burke wanted no revolution but constitutional reform. And the publication of the pamphlet by Edmund Burke produced various responses, swift responses. Mary Wollstonecraft Godwin produced two essays, Vindication of the Rights of Man and Vindication of the Rights of Women. And Thomas Paine, who influenced the French Revolution and American Revolution also, who came to America and produced essays and worked for the American Revolution, produced the essay Rights of Man. And the names of the essays that we have to remember: Vindication of the Rights of Man, written by Wollstonecraft, Mary Wollstonecraft Godwin, the wife of Godwin, the anarchist philosopher. And she was also a revolutionary, and she supported the revolution, and she spoke about the rights of man, celebrating the rights of man. To fight against the aristocracy and the rich is actually the rights of man, and it is a vindication, celebration of the rights of man. And again, Thomas Paine also produced an essay, Rights of Man. And he also produced an essay called Common Sense. Common Sense was an essay that influenced the American Revolution. The American colonies became independent through a revolution, and it was influenced by Thomas Paine's essay, Common Sense. And it was influenced by Addison's play, Cato also. Cato also influenced the American Revolution. Give me liberty or give me death was a slogan developed through the play Cato by Addison. And then Paine also wrote in support of the American Revolution, and his pamphlet Common Sense, and we come to discuss about Common Sense in the American area. And Thomas Paine, even though was born in England, came to America and influenced the American Revolution, and he worked with whom? In the Pennsylvania Chronicle. He worked with whom? Benjamin Franklin. He worked with Benjamin Franklin. Thomas Paine was actually identified by Benjamin Franklin. It was Benjamin Franklin, the first American. He is called the first American. And it was he who identified Thomas Paine and brought him to America and made him so a journalist in the Pennsylvania Chronicle. He became editor in the Pennsylvania Chronicle, and Thomas Paine produced several essays, and one among them was the popular essay Common Sense, and it influenced the American Revolution. And Paine, for his support of the French Revolution, was ordered to be executed by hanging. Paine was sentenced to death by hanging, but he escaped a punishment by living in France, and then he went to America and wrote the Common Sense, the essay Common Sense, that influenced the American Revolution. And we come to find the poets of the period and about their reaction towards the revolution, and Wordsworth and the French Revolution. Wordsworth visited France in 1791, some 2 years after the fall of Bastille. And it was at the time the revolution didn't actually take a gory turn. It didn't take a bloody turn. And he wrote his poem, The Preludes, the lines, "Bliss was it in that dawn to be alive, but to be young was very heavy." So this seems to be very important lines, his reaction towards the French Revolution. And it was also asked by UGC once. So, "Bliss was in that dawn to be alive, but to be young was very heaven." So it was a bliss to be alive during the French Revolution and to be a young man. And Wordsworth was a young man. Wordsworth was only 21 years when he visited France. He was born in 1770 and he was only 21 years. So he was only 21 years when the revolution took place. And to be young again was very heaven. And he lost his first in the revolution. Wordsworth went to France and remained there for some time. Came into friendship with a lady named Annette Wallin, and a girl child was also born in the relationship. And he wanted to continue in France, and he was happy with the developments there. But when the revolution took a bloody turn, a gory turn, so he hated the revolution and he wanted to escape from there. And he left Annette Wallin and his daughter. And the daughter was not born then. He left the pregnant Annette Wallin and returned to England and didn't go back to France. So, for about 10 years. And after 10 years, he again went to France. In fact, to get permission from Annette Wallin for his marriage with Mary Hutchinson. So he got married with Mary Hutchinson, who was a colleague with him during his college days, during his school days also. And Coleridge was also influenced by the revolution. He was attracted by the ideals. And following the footsteps of the revolution, he produced a poem also, The Fall of Bastille. The Fall of Bastille was a poem produced by him in 1789 itself. So when the fall of the Bastille took place and when it came to be known to the other countries, when it came to be known in England, he produced the poem The Fall of Bastille. It was his second poem. One of the earliest poems produced by Coleridge was on the fall of Bastille, on the fall of the prison Bastille in France, which marked the beginning of the revolution. And with Sade, he planned to establish a society, a socialist society, an egalitarian society called Pandisocracy. And influenced by the revolution, Coleridge and Sade wanted to produce a socialistic society by the bank of the river Susquehanna in America. They wanted to start a society called Pandisocracy. So, a society of equalitarian ideals. And they meant Pandisocracy as equal government by and for all. So in the essay of, in the area of Coleridge and in the area of Sade, we come to find the details about Pandisocracy. Pandisocracy was a society they wanted to establish by the banks of the river Susquehanna in America. And they wanted the place to be ruled by the people there, and for the people, by the people, and for the betterness of the people. Equal government for all, one and all. And for that, Coleridge got married also. So they got married with Edith Trickle. And Coleridge had no option. He also wanted to have a family. In fact, he married Edith's sister, Sarah Trickle. He got married with Sarah Trickle. It was a abandoned, a foolish decision as far as Coleridge was concerned. And Sarah was a blooming idiot, whereas Coleridge was a blooming intellect. So, and Coleridge also aborted the revolution when it became bloody. And Wordsworth aborted the revolution, condemned the revolution when it turned to a bloody turn. And Coleridge also scorned the revolution, condemned the revolution. And Shelley and the revolution, and Byron and the revolution. Shelley actually didn't see the revolution. He didn't see the revolution taking place. But he was a great supporter of the revolution. And from his college days onwards, he stood against tradition and always stood for revolutionary views. He stood for revolutionary views. And for example, his Necessity of a Theism, that was produced when Shelley was in the school, Eton School. So it represents the outlook of Shelley towards the revolution. So when he was in the Eton School, he produced an essay called The Necessity of a Theism. And for the pamphlet, he was suspended from the school. And it was the end of his school studies also. He produced The Necessity of a Theism. And Shelley was actually not alive during the period. He was very young. He was very young when the revolution took place. Shelley was very young. Shelley was born in 1792 and the revolution started in 1789. And Shelley was not there when the Bastille fell. Shelley was born in 1792 and the fall of Bastille took place in 1789. Even then, Shelley had great support for the revolution. He was also always on the side of the revolution. And his essay Necessity of a Theism, for example. And after the revolution, French government was controlled by Napoleon. The rule came to Napoleon Bonaparte. And Napoleon turned out to be a dictator. And he announced himself as a monarch. And he brought the country to absolute monarchy. And continued the country as its emperor. And tried to invade the neighboring countries also. And conducted a series of wars. And there were a series of wars fought against Napoleon between 1803 and until his fall in 1815. Napoleon fell in 1815 at Waterloo, and it is very popular. It was his Waterloo. At the port of Belgium, he was defeated, and he was put in an island for a few days. He was put under imprisonment, and he became dead there. And the Allied forces continued the battle for almost 12 years, from 1803 to 1815, and this period is called the Napoleonic period of the Napoleonic Wars. And the other things that influenced the Romantic Revival was free trade. Adam Smith came out with his Wealth of Nations. Adam Smith was an economist who belonged to the circle of Dr. Johnson. Adam Smith came out with his book Wealth of Nations, and it inaugurated the trend of free market economics. And he proposed a system of free trade. Adam Smith proposed a system of free trade where government does not interfere in imports. So in such a free trade, government will not interfere in import or exports. Government will not engage in the import and the exports. And the system is also called, the system introduced by Adam Smith was also called laissez-faire. And Adam Smith is also to be remembered when we go into the Romantic Revival. So the economic situation was changed. The economic situation of England was changed based on the opinions of Adam Smith. He produced his book, Wealth of Nations. He was an economist who was there with Doc Johnson. He was in the circle of Dr. Johnson. And then the other things that influenced the revolution were the drastic rise in population. There was a dramatic rise in population. And there was also widespread fear that the land would be unable to provide food for all the people. And it was commonly believed that the land would not be able, and the idea was proposed by Malthus, a demographer and a popular economist, Thomas Malthus. He came out with his essay, Principles of Population, and in the essay he maintained that if population would rise like this, the earth would not be able, nature would not be able to give food to all the people. The nature will not be able to provide food for all. And it was refuted by the opinion of Malthus. Thomas Malthus was opposed by, refuted by William Godwin, and William Godwin maintained the human perfectibility and the perfectibility of the nature. And if there would be a rise in population, nature would adjust with the rise of the population. And with growth of population, there were the riots, and the riots became very common, and these were harshly dealt by, and there were the independent riots also for freedom, for employment, for more wages, for more rights, for voting power. And there were the food riots also, and the slogan raised by them was bread or blood. And these were all things that paved the way for the Romantic Revival. The Romantic Revival was influenced by all these things. The Romantic Revival was influenced basically by the French Revolution, by the American Revolution, and by the Napoleonic Wars. And the poets also reacted to the revolution. So Wordsworth was a supporter of the revolution in the beginning. Coleridge was also a supporter of the revolution in the beginning. But they all abhorred the revolution, scorned the revolution when the revolution took a bloody turn. And Edmund Burke opposed the revolution with his essay Reflections on the Revolution in France. And it was written in the format, the pamphlet was written in the format of a letter addressed to Charles de Pons, so a French aristocrat. And it was answered by Mary Wollstonecraft Godwin with her essay Rights of Vindication of the Rights of Man. And Thomas Paine also produced an essay, Rights of Man. And Thomas Paine influenced the French Revolution that he was ordered to be hanged to death, and he escaped from England and reached France and lived there. And later he went to America, produced his essay, Common Sense, joined with Benjamin Franklin for bringing out the Pennsylvania Chronicle, and the essays of Thomas Paine, the pamphlets and the work of Thomas Paine and Benjamin Franklin influenced the American Revolution, and 13 colonies of America became independent and they came to be called United States of America. And the Romantic Revival was influenced by all this. And then there was the Napoleonic War between 1803 to 1815. And during Napoleonic Wars, the people were not permitted to pass through France, and when Byron wanted to pass through France, so he took another way because of the Napoleonic Wars. Napoleonic Wars created great terror in the European countries, and the fights continued by the European allies against him for almost 12 years, and at the end he was defeated at Waterloo, and this also influenced the Romantic Revival. And there was also free trade, the economic developments promoted by, suggested by Adam Smith through his book Wealth of Nations, and he suggested an economic theory called laissez-faire, so allowed to do everyone the business without the intervention of the government in export or import. And Adam Smith was a member in the circle of Doc Johnson, and then population started growing up. There was a widespread fear that the nature will not be able to provide food for all the people, and the opinion was brought forward by the economics and demographer Thomas Malthus. He published an essay called The Principles of Population. He was an expert of population studies, and it spoke about population growth and the dangers inherent in the growth of the population. And it was refuted by William Godwin, the anarchist philosopher, and he made a famous debate, and it outlined the human perfectibility. If there would be increase in the population, the human beings would adjust with the resources of the nature. And there were riots at the same time. There were riots in England also for more wages, for employment, for voting rights, and there were the food rights also, and they raised the slogan bread or blood. Then there was the Luddite movement also, attacked machines which were thought to replace, and there was Luddite movement against the revolution also. So when the machines were introduced, they occurred the Luddite movement, standing against the machines. And there were also campaign for voting powers, and in this context we specially referred to Hawkins, a character introduced in Caleb Williams by William Godwin. In William Godwin's novel Caleb Williams, we come to find a man named Hawkins being hanged to death. Hawkins was hanged to death for a wrong thing, wrongly accusing him for the murder of Tyrrell. And Tyrrell was actually murdered by